By Phil Cunningham, let's continue. The memoir is Known and Unknown. It's an incredible book. I cannot claim I've read it all. I'm on page 187, and it's a total of some 800 pages. Joining me now on the Celebrity Hotline is former Secretary of Defense Donald Rumsfeld. And Donald, welcome again to the Bill Cunningham Show.
Thank you so much, Bill. I'm good to be with you.
Well, let's go back in time. I had you on maybe three or four times during your time in office, and you did me the honor of inviting me to the Pentagon, and we spoke briefly there in the beautiful middle of the little park there. And at the time, I thought that you had exhibited great skill in office, and I continue to believe so. But this is one of my questions is, when this thing kicked off in 2003, I thought as a lawyer, citizen, radio talk show host, that we really had the A-team in the history of American military to conduct this campaign. We had you, who had been Secretary of Defense. We had Cheney, so to speak, Vice President, who had been Secretary of Defense. We had Bush, who walked in the shadow of his father, who won the Persian Gulf One. And then we also had Colin Powell, Secretary of State, who also was involved so intimately in Persian Gulf War One and military matters. Looking back on it, is it fair to say that things in Iraq did not turn out, despite the expertise of the leadership that I just mentioned, things did not turn out well?
Well, they certainly haven't turned out fast. The country now has, of course, elected people. They've had a constitution that they fashioned themselves. They have a parliament. They have a prime minister and a president. And they're finding their way towards a freer political and a freer economic system, and that's a good thing. There's still violence in the country. Yeah. They now have, oh, goodness, it's close to 400,000 security forces that have been trained and equipped and are contributing to security in the country. The vicious regime is gone, a regime that used chemical weapons on its own people and on its neighbor in Iran, invaded Kuwait, killed hundreds of thousands of their own people. So the world's a better place because they're gone, in my view. But the amount of time that it's taken and the lives that it's cost are a price, a heavy price.
Donald, if you had to do it again, it wasn't your call, it was the president's call, I understand. And in fact, as I recall back in time, there was never a time you told the president, let's go. It was a presidential group decision, and I'm sure it was. But if somebody would ask you at this point, because you're near the end of your life, you're in the November of your years, if somebody would say to you, did we win the war in Iraq, what would you say?
I think that we've given them a chance to fashion a brighter future for their people. And I think the world's a better place that Saddam Hussein's gone.
Did we win or lose?
Well, you know, what we're dealing with here is not something like World War One or World War Two that has a specific beginning and a specific finite end. We're dealing with something that's more like the Cold War that lasted decades, and where we're dealing not so much just with nation states, but we're dealing with insurgencies and terrorist networks and radical Islamists who are determined to kill other people. And that's quite a different thing. We're also doing it for the first time in the 21st century in the information age. This is a totally different environment for the conduct of a war.
If we knew in March of 2003 what we know now about the current lack of WMD under Saddam Hussein, if we knew then what we know now, isn't it fair to say we would not have gone to war?
I don't know what the president would have decided. Of course, we didn't know what we know now. What we knew then was that the Congress had passed a regime change in 1998. President Clinton had signed it. It was supported overwhelmingly by Republicans and Democrats. The Iraqis had resisted 17 UN resolutions. The oil for food program was fraudulent and had enormous holes in it, and Saddam Hussein was benefiting from it rather than being punished by it. Yeah. The intelligence that we had then, of course, what we knew then was that everyone agreed in the Congress, Democrats and Republicans alike, that we had a smaller margin for error because of the lethality of weapons of mass destruction. And given the conviction that everyone had, I mean, you heard the speech that Colin Powell made at the right. United Nations. Right. He spent a lot of time on that. He worked hard on it. He was a man very experienced in intelligence matters. And he believed every word he said.
And he wasn't a fool. He knew or should have known. You're not a fool. One of the things that drives me crazy as an American that supports greatly American soldiers is the throwing around of the term lied. It's almost as if you knew there weren't WMD, Powell knew there wasn't, Cheney knew there wasn't, Bush knew there wasn't, and you concocted, which is a term used by the radical lefties in this country, concocted this WMD in order to get America into a war that we couldn't win. When I hear stuff like that, it drives me nuts.
It's disgraceful. I think the other thing to remember is that the Dulfer report at the end of the war went in there, looked at the capabilities for weapons of mass destruction that the regime had, and concluded that he had the people in groups. He had the precursors needed to rapidly expand his chemical and biological capabilities. So it isn't as though he didn't have those capabilities, because he was in a position to rapidly expand them. I mean, if you think about it, our troops put on chemical protective suits as they came in out of Kuwait expecting to be hit with weapons of mass destruction and chemical and biological weapons. They didn't do that because they like to wear those things. They're uncomfortable.
Well, was there planning in the Pentagon or in the State Department what to do after the military victory? Because I think Tommy Franks, I've had him on a couple times, he's ready to come home. It was a 30-day deal. I'm getting the hell out of here. It seemed like one of the biggest miscalculations politically, not militarily, politically, was the belief that Iraqis themselves would arise and be able to have a functioning democracy instead of everything that we've gone through for the last 8 years. Was that a large miscalculation, the thought that the Iraqis themselves had a fundamentally broken society that couldn't function?
No, I think that there was intelligence that was wrong. No mistake about that. But the people who talked about it would be easy were, for the most part, not in government. No one that I dealt with at senior levels thought it would be easy. The Tom Franks Central Command had the responsibility of developing phase 1, 2, 3, and 4, and phase 4 was the post-major combat operations, and there was an enormous amount of planning that took place. You're quite right about him personally. He did not want to stay, but that's his choice. But the planning was done in the National Security Council. It was done in the State Department. It was done in the Department of Defense. Now, what you have to remember is, think of what Dwight Eisenhower said. He said, the plan is nothing. Planning is everything. Now, why would he say that? He said that a plan gets thrown out with first contact with the enemy. You find that things are different than what you expected. There are surprises. The intelligence proved not to predict an insurgency, for example. So the enemy's got a brain. And the minute you go into battle and engage, you're going to have to change whatever plans you had, because the enemy adapts and adjusts. And that's throughout history. It's the story of warfare. It's always mysterious. It's always changing. And there are always surprises. I mean, you look at World War II the Civil War or World War, any war. And the idea that the big difference, the biggest difference is it's the 21st century and we have an information age, and everyone has an email and a video camera and a photo camera and 24-hour news, and everything is examined and examined. We didn't even have television during the Korean War or World War II. Let alone the kinds of electronic capabilities today. A lie goes around the world three times before the truth gets its boots on.
Now, in this case, Donald, do you have trouble? Have you thought about not traveling to Europe, some socialist capitals in Europe, because of fear of arrest? There was some story a few weeks ago about it was either you or the president. I think George Bush couldn't travel to Switzerland because he might be arrested.
Yeah, I read that story. There's sort of a movement in the world towards something called universal jurisdiction, right, where the laws of your own country don't apply to you. The laws of any country can apply. And we had that problem in Belgium, where Belgium passed that law. And when I found out about it, some prosecutor put a suit on Tommy Franks.
Right.
and said they would arrest him if he came in the country. And I said, fine, we'll move NATO out of Belgium. How do you like that? If we can't bring our military people into this country, unless you've got to change that law. Well, they changed the law within, I think, 72 hours.
Great.
No. But I did see that about the president, and it's a dangerous thing. I'll tell you where it would lead. It would lead to American isolationism. What would happen is we would be unwilling. For example, I wouldn't, as Secretary of Defense, be willing to send all of our troops and ships to help out in the Indonesian tsunami if I thought some of our people were going to be arrested.
Yeah.
Kissinger still has trouble traveling around the world, I'm told, because of things back in the 1970s.
Right.
Every once in a while, there's some Spanish rogue prosecutor who does something every once in a while to promote this. But it's a dangerous thing, and we have some Air Force officers who were involved in assisting the CIA in something in Italy, and they've been indicted there, and they can't travel. So it is a problem. We have to address it. We want our people tried and prosecuted under our own laws and not under the whims of every country on the face of the earth.
Is America's military in good shape under President Barack Obama?
Well, America's military, of course, had suffered from about 8 or 10 years of defunding during the Clinton, at the end of the Cold War, and until President George W. Bush went in. We have dramatically changed the military in the time we were there. I mean, the numbers of UAVs that are enabling us to do what we do, the numbers of special forces and their equipment and their authorities are vastly increased. We've moved from a division army to a brigade combat team army, which enables us to take smaller units very rapidly with full capabilities wherever they're needed in the world. We've rearranged the force posture in the world. And think back to the Vietnam War, if you want a contrast. I mean, we've got an all-volunteer army. Every
right.
single person there is there because they want to be there.
Right.
And that is such a blessing. They're proud of what they do. They know what they do well. They spend time in the military and get very good at it. I think our country's so fortunate to have these talented people serving our country and putting their lives at risk for us.
Now, lastly, on in 06, when Bush took a drubbing indirectly at the polls and you left the Secretary of Defense position, when you walked out of the Pentagon for the last time as Secretary of Defense, did you walk out with a heavy heart or did you walk out with a feeling of accomplishment?
Oh, definitely a feeling of accomplishment. You hate. It's not your first choice to be Secretary of Defense during a war. You know that a president's decision or your decision to send young men and women into battle situations where they can be wounded or killed, you have to have such respect for them. And each life is a treasure, and each death is a tragedy. So that weighs heavy on you every day you're there. But I certainly left feeling that the Department of Defense and the United States Armed Forces have been left vastly improved and that our country's a safer place. There wasn't a day there after September 11th that I didn't think that my job was to help protect the American people and to do everything I could to look out for the lives of the men and women in uniform. Here we are close to a decade later. And there's not been another successful attack on America.
Right.
Now, the Bush administration did some things very right, and our country has benefited by not being attacked in the period since.
Do you have any questions for me?
No, I don't. I tell you, I think what you folks do is terrific. You inform and you listen to your listeners, and you allow us to come on and discuss important public issues, and I thank you for it.
Well, Donald Rumsfeld, you're a great American. I guess your time in public life is now done. I doubt I will ever have you on again, but whenever I've been with you, you've been a gentleman. I love the fact that those around you respect you, and it is an honor to have on a person that represented America's military so well in two stints of office. And I would mention that all the proceeds from the book go to help the families of fallen soldiers, and also it's number one on the New York Times bestseller list. How about that?
Well, that's I'm sure it drives the New York Times nuts.
Really? And a day in which the New York Times is driven nuts has got to be a good day for most Americans. Thank you very much. Known and unknown, and I'm not sure we'll do it again. But, Donald, it's been a pleasure having you on over the years, and Godspeed to you and your lovely wife.
Thank you so very much.
God bless you.
Bye.
All right, let's continue with more. 700 WLW.